Global platform is Mr. Anil Kumar. So Mr. Anil is the founder of Samunati Financial Intermediation and Services Private Limited. So Samunati was established in November 2014 and offers financial, co-financial and non-financial solutions to marginal, small and medium holders, including farmers, agri enterprises and wholesale retailers. So Mr. Anil is a career banker with over 24 years of experience in the area of rural, retail and agri-banking. Over the last decade, Mr. Anil's work was focused on creating newer institutions across the country and operating in the financially excluded markets with corresponding support structures for the capacity building. Prior to Samunati, Anil was a co-founder and trustee of IFMR Trust and the CEO of IFMR Rural Channels. So today he's here to give you an intro about the agricultural value chains, the growing opportunities associated with it, and the latest trends in this business. We welcome you, Mr. Anil. Over to you. Thank you. Thank you and good evening everyone. A warm welcome to you all. I'll space my time with you in two parts. One, quickly go through a short deck that I have put together to tell about what Samunati is. A 2-3 slide presentation, not more than that. And then perhaps I'll take the help of a whiteboard and a marker to explain how we in Samunati see value chain and how we go about structuring financial products, because a concept model of value chain finance we couldn't try to fit in one slide, even with transitions. So with your permission, I would become perhaps a professor in IIT campus, take you through what we understand by value chain finance and how we have gone about building customized products and solutions for agriculture per se. Is that okay? Great. So Samunati as an institution is focused only on agriculture and allied activities, nothing else. And founded in 2014, we are a set of people who have worked extensively in the rural finance space as part of IFMR. I'm one of the founder trustees of IFMR Trust. And a couple of us who were working in ICSA Bank were sent on deputation in 2007 to set up IFMR Trust here in Chennai. And within IFMR, I was the CEO of IFMR Rural Channels that the gentleman mentioned in my intro. But what IFMR Rural Finance did is set up 6 small finance bank-like institutions, 4 in Tamil Nadu, 1 in the hills of Uttarakhand, in the Gadwal Hills, and 1 in Orissa. And these 6 institutions were designed to provide multiple products to remote rural. So the idea was not financially excluded, but remote rural, wherein we had branch as a channel. We had about 222 branches when I called it a day there, with about 500,000 customers. And we were able to provide about 14 products across assets, liabilities, payments, and remittances. Those 8 years of being in rural finance space gave us a lot of understanding of how do these markets work. And as a banker, one of the definitions of risk management for me is how do we manage the risks of the activities associated for which you are funding, and if they are able to make good use of that money and they are able to generate income is when we as bankers would get our money back. And some of the principles you will see when I share our understanding of how we see the value chains in the second part of our presentation. But all that after sharing with you where we are on balance sheet. So we started off in 2014. We have had a good run so far. This March we have closed with a reasonable balance sheet. We are about 300 crore entity in terms of assets under management. We have disbursed about 750 crores so far. And the best part has been that we work with about 250 and odd community-based organizations that cut across societies, cooperatives, as well as farmer producer companies. And with these kind of community-based organizations, we work in about 12 value chains, which include dairy, maize, tapioca, turmeric, oil seeds, paddy and wheat seeds, fruits and vegetables, jasmine, spices, so on and so forth. The model is a B2B2C model, so we don't need to be physically present to be able to expand our footprint. So we operate in about 12 states in these collaborative structures. And these community-based organizations that we work cumulatively have an outreach of 1 million farmers. So what I tell my team is, even if we stop acquiring newer community-based organizations or newer clients, and if we are able to serve this 1 million farmers, our job is done. So that's the potential that this country and the sector has. So 2014, when I started talking about agriculture and lending, one thing that was common for me is people started talking about a Bollywood formula. Agriculture lending, monsoon failure, over-indebtedness, inability to pay, and one bad news in the papers, and then we had it. Why do you want to get into this kind of a segment? Having worked in the rural space, and many of you are operating in this space, you would know that pre-harvest finance, though exposed to these risks, is one aspect of agriculture. Agriculture is not equal to crop loan. There is a lot to agriculture than just crop loans. And as a banker, having spent 25 years in structuring financial products for these customers, I also realized that a lot of riskiness that we see in the agriculture sector is attributed to the bad product design that we as bankers have given out to the farmers, wherein the risk management is pass on all the risks to the farmer, cover as much of your base as possible, then pray. It doesn't work. Unless you participate in what happens with the money, how do you link the markets, how do you leverage the power of aggregation, and how do you work with these entities to be able to bring better practices of productivity gains, whichever. This is sector agnostic. As a banker, you need to do all of this for all your customers. Fortunately, these kind of services are available for corporate clients. You have dedicated relationship manager, you have customized products and solutions, you have structuring teams to be able to slice and dice the portfolio to be able to do whatever you want. You have trade services to take care of your market linkages. But when it comes to agriculture, none of these services are available. So what we are aiming to do as Samunnati is to bring those aspects into product structuring in agriculture. So accordingly, we don't have specific products for our customers. We are a solution company. We sit across the table and say, what works for you? And in doing so, we structure products that are linked to the cash flows associated with the economic activity that the farmers engage in. So we have loans ranging from 4,000 rupees, a single loan, to about 5 crores. And in terms of quantum and in terms of tenor, ranging from 4 days to 5 years. So when somebody says, what do you lend for? We say, first, let's talk about what do you do, so that our lending is an extension of what you do. Whenever we talk about customized product solutions, we have to talk about, okay, how are we different? How do we assess? How do we underwrite any loan? So primary approach that we have taken is the non-traditional ways of approaching. We don't believe in lag indicators. We don't believe in entities looking into rear view mirror and trying to race 100, 120 kilometers per hour. They just don't help. Two, in a sector where we are looking at bringing about new products and structures, there is no point in what happened earlier. And in the context of the community-based organizations that we work with, if you ask these community-based organizations, what is the turnover that you have done last year or the year before, they would say, sir, we never got any money to do anything meaningful. So why do you want to ask those questions? So when you know that the fuel is not available, why ask for acceleration and velocity? No point. So we don't look at the lag indicators. Two, we don't believe in collateral being the primary aspect for lending. Because as banker, I know the thing that helps one pay back is the ability to earn after using the money for which it is borrowed for. No cash flows, no repayment. That's a simple rule. What do we do with the building, land, and what have you? And if it is in agriculture, what do I do with the cattle? I would not even have the working capital to feed them. Forget about taking them and keeping them in a particular place. So whenever we are looking at customized products and solutions as an institution, we realized way back that we have to get out of how traditional bankers would look at assessing the credit risk. And that is what we have been attempting to do in Samunati, wherein we leverage two kinds of capital. And both of them are not financial capital. We leverage social capital, which I will explain when I get back to the second part of my presentation on the whiteboard. And two, the trade capital, which is a transaction history that exists between the players in the value chain. And fortunately, we are the only players in this space doing this in India. And the other aspect of the word fortunate is we have to learn at our cost. So we learn at our cost, we make mistakes, we learn and check along. The model is a non-linear model, it is a B2B2C model. And the middle B represents the players within value chain for us. We, as an organization, don't believe in disintermediation, because intermediator or intermediary or the middleman, though often misunderstood, brings in a lot of value in moving goods and cash up and downstream. Again, with due apologies to my reputation, when I explain the role that an intermediary plays in moving goods and cash across the value chain is where you realize the value add that the intermediary brings about. And if you take a typical farmer, the farmer would produce one or two varieties of crop given the geographical area that they operate in. But when we as consumers step into a store, we would want all the varieties that are known, consumed across the world to be available in the SKUs when we enter. So when you look at going directly to the farmer, you would be faced with the challenge of two or three varieties in bulk quantities in different size and shapes. Whereas when we go to the retail outlet, Karthik's Sunny Beach store, for example, we would want to pick the specific type, specific size of vegetables, which not only look good, but also are of specific sizes. This grading sorting itself is a huge value add that intermediaries provide to farmers, because farmers don't have control to determine the size and shape of their produce, but they would want someone to buy everything that they produce. The moment they start going to large retailers, the challenge that they would face is there is cherry picking. Cherry picking of financial assets, cherry picking of physical assets. Both are challenging. Because what is left over in financial parlance is called toxic assets. Whereas in agri-produce, they are unsaleable assets. They cannot afford. And hence, the value of intermediary is an important dimension. So Samunati recognizes that value. Second, on the field, again, when we started interacting with the intermediaries, we also realized that intermediary is just not moving goods and cash across the value chain. They are also providing several value-added services to their members to keep the flock together. And these include, at times, being lender of the last resort. Many of the members who supply to the intermediaries take advances for their requirements because they don't have access to bank funding. Two, when they create an asset, it is given that the intermediary will have to participate in part funding of the asset. And if it is a cow, 50,000 rupee cow, the intermediary is, or Palkaran, aggregator, is expected to put in about 5,000 in that. So co-creation, the capital formation also happens in that way. So Samunati does not, long story short, Samunati does not believe in disintermediation as a way to scale. In fact, what we look at is, how do we opt them in? How do we work with the intermediaries to be able to make the value chain operate at a higher equilibrium so that the trickle-down effect on both sides would accrue to the farmer? And this is what makes us a non-linear model, and this is what I will try to explain on the whiteboard now, if you want, okay? And this realization came when we have recently closed our Hello? No? Yes?
Yes, sir. keep talking.
Okay, as long as you are able to follow me, that's fine. I'm not able to hear my own voice. We have recently concluded our Series C. Series C, equity raise.
Please go ahead, sir.
Okay. Equity raise. And we started off with a beautiful corporate presentation with the help of investment bankers. A 45 slide presentation. After taking them through 45 slide presentation, then I said, can you give me 15-20 minutes? And I did this. From next meeting onwards, my investment banker said, forget about our presentation, do this. So that is a conference with which I'm trying to now come back and explain Samunati model on how we build customized products and solutions by leveraging the principles of value chain finance. And some of you who are interested in product structuring would perhaps see a different approach. And some of you interested in agri space would be able to think and look at your financing requirements in a different context. Okay. So whenever we talk about value chain finance, you have producer and the consumer. And this consumer need not necessarily be you and me. In the context of agriculture, whenever there is a processing involved is where there's a consumer. For example, if you take maize as the product, animal feed company could be the consumer. Ultimately, the cow consumes that animal feed, but raw material processed and used is the consumer. When you look at dairy, the milk processing units could be the consumers, not the end customer. That's not the consumer that we are looking at here. The goods move always in this direction, from producer to the consumer, primarily, and cash moves from the consumer to the producer, always. And the nature of who makes this movement of goods and cash possible depends on the nature of the value chain. And usually, these guys who facilitate the movement of goods and cash are referred to as aggregators, intermediaries, dalals, wholesalers, what have you. But their primary role is facilitate movement of goods from producer to consumer, facilitate movement of cash from the consumer to the producer. And this aggregator, we will call them as aggregators for the rest of our conversation, this aggregators and their nature depends on the number of producers that they deal in. If they deal in, say, about 100 producers or about 500 producers, or about 5,000, all indicative numbers, and 5,000 plus. Closer to the producer, less number of producers is where the aggregator is informal or individual. The milk aggregator typically is that kind of a guy. Or a large farmer who also aggregates vegetables from nearby small farmers is an aggregator. Right? All the way up, someone who is dealing with more than 5,000 producers is institutional and formal. Amul is a classic example of that. Fab India, for example, is a classic example. Any large aggregator who directly works with farmers is also a good example. Well, Sunnybee is an example of institutional and formal entities. Right? Someone in between institutional and formal entities are quasi-institutional, quasi-individual, and these are societies, cooperatives, and the new breed of entities that are called farmer-producer companies. I don't know how many of you are aware of this new company under the Indian Companies Act, which came in last decade. Farmer-producer companies are companies registered under the Indian Companies Act with all governance structures. So they are supposed to be the better governed entities as compared to cooperatives, but the principle of cooperation remains there. It is member-owned, member-operated. So all these entities are partly informal and partly institutional. And we call them as community-based organizations, CBOs. Whether it is an individual aggregator or an institutional aggregator, the primary role that they do is
buy downstream and sell upstream. Buy and sell, buy and sell, buy and sell. Always in that order, not the reverse. And in doing so, they are creating two kinds of capitals. One is what we call the social capital. Social capital is nothing but the soft information that exists between the buyer and seller, or between two individuals who are interacting over a period of time, living together in a say, common society over a period of time. And those of you who are aware of microfinance, Mahesh should know about it, know the power of social capital, know the power of soft information. The entire microfinance sector indeed is built on one capital, which is social capital. I know, madam, I can reasonably vouch for her credibility. You can give a loan, and if she does not repay, I have moral suasion to tell, please repay, is what social capital is all about. The entire microfinance sector is built on social capital, right? But in the context of the value chains that we are talking, the social capital is built because of frequent buy and sell that is happening between the producer and the intermediary, or between intermediary level 1 and intermediary level 2. And mind you, in value chain, it's not linear always. It's not necessary that P has to sell to A1, A1 to A2, A2 to A3. A3 can directly go to B, P can directly go to A3. However, P to C is not possible. The grading sorting that I said, P to C is difficult because C's requirements are specific. I need so much of quantity of this grade and of this nature. And it is best facilitated by at least one intermediary in between. Right. So this buy and sell is happening between these two guys over a period. And whenever we ask an aggregator saying, how many members do you have? Two answers come. One, we have about 200 members. We have about 500 members. We have about 5,000 members. But X number are active. So these two pieces of information would indicate two things. While many are associated with them, there are few that they are familiar with. So as lenders, when we go and say, how many people do you vouch for in those active members, that number reduces by another half. Well, I have 100 members, 40, 50 are regular, but I can vouch for 20 people. This vouching for 20 people is the example that I gave, saying, I know these guys are credible, which is social capital. Second one is, unlike microfinance, where the social capital is a basis to lend and the amounts are smaller amounts, these are happening in the context of specific transactions, you also have transaction history. Not only that I am dealing with this gentleman for last 5 years, my volume of transaction with this gentleman has been 4 lakhs every year, 5 lakhs every year, 2 lakhs every year. So there is a quantification because the interaction is happening in the specific context of buying and selling. If it is milk, they would say number of liters. Yeah, I know, I have been procuring milk for about 5 years. Last 1 year, it has been on an average 40 liters a day. So the transaction history that exists between these two guys on account of being able to buy and sell is what is trade capital. In other words, from the banker perspective, we are looking at social capital on whom to lend, and trade capital on how much to lend. The moment you take these two capitals, the fundamental nature of how to structure a transaction moves from collateral based to cash flow based. Because the transaction history is what is determining how much you are lending. If there are two farmers, farmer A having 10 cows and say 100 acres of land, farmer B having 10 cows but 2 acres of land. When we are structuring a transaction for the output of 10 cows, the 100 acres and 2 acres of land are irrelevant for us. Also, a farmer who is supplying about 40 liters of milk a day, having 10 members in the house, another farmer supplying 40 liters of milk, having 2 members in the house, again is not relevant for us because how much to lend is on what is the transaction volume that is happening for that specific economic activity. We don't consider the rest of the cash flows associated with other activities. Right? What this would do is the moment we look at how much to lend, then we bring the alignment of incentives between the intermediaries, producer and the consumer, wherein we say you are buying from them as an aggregator, as an intermediary, you are also giving me a transaction history and you are telling me who are all your trusted members. Can you also help me deduct the payment that you are anyhow making before it reaches the borrower? In other words, the intermediary in Samunati's context is part of the transaction. And why do they do it? Would be a question that would come to you. Why would an intermediary look at guaranteeing the payment? And if we ask someone saying, can you guarantee? You would say, what is in it for me? What is in it for me is where the economics come into picture. Other than the producer and the consumer, rest of them are all interested in volume. Because their revenue is a function of two things. Value per unit, number of units. Value per unit is determined by the market. 25 rupees per litre of milk, 22 rupees per litre of milk, 27 rupees per litre of milk, but it operates in a range. You cannot suddenly say, my milk is 40 rupees per litre. Nobody would buy that. Right? So it operates in a range. So value per unit is determined by the market. Number of units is determined by me, which is the aggregator. They can increase their revenue by increasing the number of units. And some of this model is, how do we work with them to be able to increase the turnover in the value chain? And that's our stated mission. We say making the value chain operate at a higher equilibrium. Higher equilibrium is throughput. Increase the volume so that the value chain would get lubricated better. Right. When we do that is when the aggregators would agree to deduct the payment and pay. So as a banker, if you see, in other words, in the B2B2C model that Samunati has, the middle B is the aggregator, and this aggregator on the supply side could be a CBO, and on the demand side could be an agri enterprise taking or buying the goods for their further processing. Other than these dynamics, Samunati does not consider anything else to structure the production services. And once this principle is deployed in our customer acquisition, we then have started designing or started our work on the operating principles. If we have to operate in Bihar, if we have to operate in Uttar Pradesh, if we have to operate in Kerala, how do we operate without opening our physical branches is where our operating principles come in. We are a cashless and a paperless entity to the extent where the legal papers are not involved. We do take agreements, but to the extent possible, we are paperless, but definitely cashless. All our loan disbursements go into the borrower's bank account, and all repayments happen through deduction at source. So there is no cash. And our channel strategy is what we call the PHI strategy, point of high impact. There, that location in the value chain which provides us enough visibility of the buy side and sell side of the value chain. So all our branches are usually in the mandis, where the buyers and sellers are interacting continuously. And this PHI has three dimensions. Base PHI is where we have our office. And we have offices in about seven states now. Satellite PHI is where one of our representatives would sit in the office of one of our aggregators. If it is a community-based organization or a farmer producer company, our guys will sit in their office or they are attached to specific customers. And mobile PHI is where, mobile PHI is where our representative would handle four or five relationships in a go and then slowly nurture the relationship and become the satellite PHI. So the graduation is start with mobile PHI, become a satellite PHI, and if we have enough traction, then open our own office there. So that's the channel strategy. So the entity is about 3 years old now, out of 250 people. The senior management are basically bankers, so we have about 250 years of banking experience. From our perspective, all that it would mean is we know what not to do. What to do, we are figuring out on a daily basis. And I keep saying, we are a unique organization where we have to learn at our cost. So we are learning at our cost. But thankfully, the market is so big in agriculture that whatever we do is still a rounding up. So we don't worry about competition. As many people to collaborate, as many people to work together. We believe extensively in use of technology in this space. So anyone interested in technology, we go to them. Anyone interested in linking markets, we go to them. That's how we ended up meeting Karthik a year ago, and we work together extensively. That's how we ended up meeting with Rajesh, and we work extensively. So when we sit together, we say, forget about what has not happened. We have customers who have been doing what they have been doing for about 10 years. We also have a customer who has done the first transaction of selling to a large buyer, and we have funded that transaction. Only transaction, first transaction, with an equity base of about 2 lakhs and a vintage of 2 months. Because the moment the buyer is strong and buyer is giving the DAS, deduction at source, you really don't need to worry about the seller, provided the seller has discharged 4 responsibilities. 1, supply the quality that is required, determine the price that you have negotiated for, sell the good, and not take the responsibility for storage. So price risk, quality risk, storage risk, and transportation risk. These are the 4 risks that are best taken by the buyer and seller if someone else does not take those risks. So I stop there. Karthik also needs some time. If we have more time, we can interact later on. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Anil. So up next, we have Mr. Karthik Jayaraman, our final speaker. So Mr. Karthik is an alumnus of IIT Madras and the Indian School of Business, and he also worked in McKinsey and Company. So he has 16 years of experience across engineering, automotive, management consultancy, etc. Currently, he is the founding team member of a startup called Way Cool Foods and Products. So Mr. Karthik drives the overall architecture of the venture with particular focus on sourcing, processing, supply chain operations, and setting up business processes. So he is here to talk to us. So over to you, Mr. Karthik.
Good evening, everyone. I think I'd just like to take on straight from where Anil left this. We have probably a fairly prototype example of nonlinear growth powered by Samunati. We started about 2.5 years ago, and in the first year and a half of our existence, we probably grew at a pace of maybe 5 to 10% every month. I think between March 2016 and March 2017, our tonnage per day of fresh produce, which is what we used to deal with at that point in time, grew from about 5 tons per day to 10 tons per day. That's when we met Samunati. Samunati trusted a bunch of novices like us, who effectively had zero to negative net worth at that point in time when we met them, with some cash. Not cash, but electronically. And I think it is the basis of that formed the basis of growth, primarily not just because of the money they put in us, but the confidence that they gave in us, that we grew from 10 tons per day to 100 tons per day in the next 12 months. So today we do 100 tons per day. We are present across the southern part of the country. We source nationally, and we don't deal just with fresh produce. We deal with all kinds of food products today. So we are probably a good prototype of how nonlinear growth of an intermediary is powered by finance that is offered through mechanisms like such as what Samunati has devised for us. As I said earlier, we are not from the industry. I personally am from automotive, heavy engineering and management consulting, essentially the PowerPoint industry in the past decade and a half. Almost every single person of the founding team does not have an agricultural background. We all have automotive engineering and similar backgrounds. We got into this space honestly because we were looking for something that was less tiring. two decades in the industry, what we realized is we've been through four turnarounds. I mean, Tata Motors or Ashok Leyland or any other company, every 5 years there will be a recession in the industry, we'll cut costs, we'll worry about working capital, etc. While we learned a lot in terms of working capital discipline, cost controls, managing very, very difficult supply chains, we were getting tired of it. We realized that only Robert Bosch and the bankers make money in that industry. So we said, why don't we maybe transfer some learnings from that industry into sectors that are unorganized and see whether we can build a scale organization, obviously with the intention of building reasonable profits, but also creating social impact beyond that. Can we create positive externalities rather than milk cycles? This was really the thought process. Agri fascinated us primarily because of the complexity of the supply chain. We are by nature supply chain people. Automotive industry has essentially become a supply chain industry about managing large, 25,000 components, I'm told, in the new Mercedes-Benz S-Class, coming at precisely the right time and the precisely the right place and it being assembled precisely the right way. So we said, is there something that's we can transfer from this category to the others? So we started touring the countryside. We visited several sections of the supply chain to understand what really this is about. And, we'll put on a bit of a management consulting hat here and start throwing some numbers over here. By the way, a lot of these numbers come with very strong disclaimers. Firstly, like I said, we are novices. So you can treat us as people who have grown from nascency to infancy. But we come with a childlike curiosity and these are merely observations that we are sharing with you. Secondly, a lot of the numbers aren't very high quality. So these are best estimates from various sources, private or public. Having said that, this is one of the largest food markets in the world. We produce about $300 billion worth of food. We add value of about $150 billion. And we pump about $500 trillion of food into various channels. Retail consumption is still the largest channel, but business consumption is a fast growing channel as well. About 80% goes still into retail consumption and 20% goes into business consumption. So we're looking at numbers like about $80 billion just going into canteens, hotels, hospitals, restaurants, etc., other than the retail outlets. Another interesting pattern that you'll see here is the modern retail chains, such as the Walmarts of the world, are still at $10 billion out of the $330 billion of retail purchase that happens for food items, food and groceries. This is after so much investment and such a long presence of modern retail in this country. I'm emphasizing this in order to tease out one of the challenges in building an agri supply chain company in this country, which I will elaborate upon shortly. Now, this is the fun part, and this is what Anil was referring to as well. The supply chain is, the value of the trade is large, but it passes through so many hands and passes through so many levels of intermediation that there is tremendous amount of friction costs that get built along the supply chain. So the first thing I must share with you is that this is not an ineffective supply chain. It is an extraordinarily effective supply chain. Day in and day out, come floods or rain or sunshine, Coimbatore market will deliver to you 200 to 250 varieties of fruits and vegetables from all over the country without fail. It is an extraordinarily effective supply chain. The question that needs to be raised is it an efficient supply chain? So effectiveness and efficiency need to be differentiated. And our thesis is that there is room for improving efficiency. Now, you can see this. If you take fruits and vegetables, for example, we have several layers of aggregation, then mandi agents, local traders, and then it goes to last mile distribution and then reaches the customer. Similarly, if you take meats and fish and other products, there are breeder farms and wet markets, slaughtering, processing, and then it reaches you. It gets a little more complicated than that. If we, for example, deep dive into fruits and vegetables, I'll focus a little more on fruits and vegetables because that's really where we started and we have a longer exposure to than some of the other categories, though we do all categories. I mean, there's been a lot of thrust by the government on transferring farmers from staples into horticulture because it is believed that horticulture improves yields for the farmer and gives them increased revenue. The latest year data is about 300 million tons, which should probably make us the largest producer of fruits and vegetables in the world, number one or number two, probably. Now, this is a very good initiative by the government, primarily because of the uncertainty around staples, the dependence on rains, etc. It's possible to become less rain dependent on horticulture and so on and so forth. However, when we conducted a survey, this was in 2015, and this is something that we read about a lot in the papers. This is just data that's backing it up. I'm sorry for those in the back, I'll just read out some of the information here. The price that a farmer receives at the farm gate is about anywhere between a fourth and a tenth of what you buy at the retail outlet. A lot has been written about this. People have said that intermediaries are making a lot of money, people are marking up their produce at very high values, etc., etc. A lot of people in the middle portion of the value chain have been vilified because of this fact. Nevertheless, I'll talk about whether they are villains or heroes, but the fact is that there is a 4x to 10x rise in price between farm gate and consumer. And this is across commodities, by and large across seasons. The reason for this is not one evil intermediary in between who is making supernormal profits. The reason is because there are so many layers from farmer to customer. Now again, I'm not emphasizing on the margins that each layer make. They each make a sliver. This is a business that runs on return on equity and rotation of capital. It is not a business that runs on margins. However, the product gets handled and rehandled multiple times, with highly variable levels of expertise in handling this product at different parts of the supply chain, which is the root cause for the increase in the price and loss of value of the products. I'll give you some examples. If you take tomatoes, for example, most people will tell you Madanapalli Mandi is the biggest mandi for tomatoes. That's true. However, there is another mandi such as Ottapalli which feeds Madanapalli. And there are intermediaries who feed Ottapalli, and there are villages that are further away which these intermediaries go to pick up the tomato and bring it here. And from Madanapalli it comes to Coimbatore and then it comes to you. Tomato which is harvested this morning will be picked up by the intermediary in the evening for all these materials. He will bring it to Ottapalli where the trade will happen the next day. It's the day after that the product reaches Madanapalli and the trade happens. And it's the day after it reaches Coimbatore market. In Coimbatore market, there are wholesalers who act as breakers of bulk. They sell to semi-wholesalers who form the intermediary ring in Coimbatore. And retailers aggregate together and they pool together money and get a Tata Ace and pick up from these people. So the tomato that we are getting is approximately 3 to 4 days old. This is number one. Number two, imagine the number of rehandlings that it has gone through in this supply chain. It's a delicate product, it's a sensitive product. In fact, during our trucking days, we had this unique challenge where Ashok Leyland had a medium duty truck, which would never be bought by people who are transporting tomato. We were wondering why, and then we realized that the boxes that I used to stack tomato, when stacked in an Ashok Leyland truck, left a 2-inch gap on the side. And that resulted in rocking, and the tomatoes got damaged. So product is sensitive, if it's not handled right, it can actually suffer a lot of losses. This is on the one end. Let's take another product on the other end. If you take avocado. Avocado is now a rapidly growing consumed item, which is actually grown in Tamil Nadu. It grows in Gudalur, it grows in Kodaikanal. Tamil Nadu is the state with probably one of the best road infrastructures in the country. And yet, the first 30 kilometers avocado is transported on horseback. Even today. It comes on horseback to a couple of loading points on the road from Kodaikanal to Pani and the road from Kodaikanal to Oddanchatram, and that is when it first sees a truck. We have videos of bags of avocado falling off the horseback into the cliff below, into the valley below. So that's wastage, that's loss straight away. Now what does this mean? The net effect is an estimated, and again a large number of disclaimers because we are finding it very difficult to trace the root data for a lot of this, but an estimated 40% value diminution. I use the term very carefully. I will not call it a loss or a wastage, it's diminution of value. Very little gets wasted in India. People find a way to reuse it, but the value of the product could have been much higher. This could have been because of moisture losses, damage, disfigurement, potentially theft, shrinkage and other factors. And also, unhygienic produce to consumers. So if you look at this, the images are obviously representative. the way people use pesticide, even at the production stage, the way people use pesticide is unregulated. The farmer typically takes tips on how to use pesticide from the pesticide seller, and you know how incentives will be aligned in that case. The post-harvest cleaning of the product. This is actually a photograph I took on the electric train from Jogeshwari to Goregaon. There is still a small patch where agriculture happens there, and they have been washing the radishes and the nalla all the time. It used to be water. Today you have two suburbs which are densely populated on both sides. It's sewage today. They don't know. Either they don't know or they are inured to it, but it still gets washed in sewage. So please be careful if you are eating radish in Bombay. Transport practices. This is on the Krishnagiri-Chennai road, which is one of the heaviest used roads for fresh produce transport. You can see that greens are kept in the bottom and hard items such as tomatoes are kept in the top. You can imagine what happens to the greens below. That's Coimbatore market, and that's actually a physical picture of the kind of dirt that lies in the market. There are known practices of adulteration. For example, injecting color or injecting sweeteners into watermelons are not unknown. There are a lot of such practices that exist. I will not say they are the rule, they may be the exception, but by and large, the quality of produce that we get does remain suspect. The advantage for us is, of course, we cook a lot of it before we eat. We are not raw food eaters to that extent, so we are not affected as badly by it. But there are these issues. Now, I'll just summarize what are the challenges in the supply chain and why this cannot be solved directly by replicating what happens in the West over here. The challenges in the supply chain are as follows. For a producer, there are two or three issues. Number one, there is inadequate access to information. The quality of information that trickles back to them typically is more in the nature of one that creates waves. If you look at tomato pricing in the last 2.5 years, the least farm gate price was 1 rupee. The maximum farm gate price was 67 rupees. 4 times in 2.5 years, the product has swung between 1 rupee and 67 rupee. Why? The only information farmers got was that the other guy is also planting because the market prices are high. So he's saying, okay, market prices are high, he's planting, let me also get on to the race. And everybody overplants. And suddenly there is a flood of tomatoes. The cost of harvesting the tomato is higher than the cost in the retail price that they get. Prices tank. Then they don't plant tomato, they switch to another crop. And then the cycle again continues. The price shoots up, and the cycle has happened 4 times in the last 2.5 years. Inadequate access to information is the primary driver. Tomato, we have actually reasonable data to prove that this is by and large price inelastic as a commodity. If the product is price inelastic, why such wide fluctuations in the price? High working capital and low net returns. Now, what happens is when a farmer actually sells the product to an intermediary, typically in most cases it's not even weighed. It is bagged, and on the bag the initials are written and it's left on the side of the field. In some more progressive states it is weighed, but by and large it is not even weighed. The first time it is weighed is when it reaches Coimbatore market. And that's the time the bag is opened and the guy calls up the intermediary and tells him so much was good quality, so much got rejected. There is no proof. And was this really good quality or not? There is no proof available. Once the sale is made, the price is determined. And everybody deducts their commission and pays the money back to the farm. This is the typical cycle. It varies by market. In fruits, the model is slightly different. For example, the orchard is pre-sold. It's pre-sold at a very, very low price, and whatever is the gain is enjoyed by the intermediary. Now, why is this happening? This is about reappropriation of risk. That's really what's happening over here. In fruits, for example, the farmer chooses to have a risk-free return, which is almost like an FD type return. On the other hand, in this case, the farmer takes a little more risk and perhaps gets a higher deal return at some point in time, but on a risk-adjusted basis, they still make less money. More importantly, a lot of working capital gets locked up. We got data to say that roughly 21 days is the working receivable cycle for many mandis in the south for farmers. In the intermediation, long, inefficient and slow supply chains, which we have covered, multiple intermediaries handling the product multiple times resulting in losses. And for the retailers and the end users, the shopping experience remains a poor one. This hasn't been an industry that has allowed scaling in retail, and therefore the shopping experience remains a mixed one. And for the B2B clients, the service levels remain poor. It's important to understand what service level means. There is a metric we use called line fill rates in this industry. If that, what that means is that if a restaurant wants 80 types of fruits and vegetables, how many have I fulfilled? If I don't fulfill all 80, half the items in a menu get killed. If I don't deliver Italian basil to an Italian restaurant, about 8 or 9 of their menu items get killed. So they cannot afford loss of field rice. But there are challenges that people face on the field rice because there aren't enough organized players to deliver them consistent field rice. Now, okay, why can't we use a Western solution as it is over here? In the US, the average size of a farm, we were told, is 488 acres. So potato moves from one 488-acre farm in Idaho, where it is completely mechanized harvesting. The harvester itself has a mechanism to grade and clean the potatoes and drop it into the containerized truck unit after bagging. The containerized truck travels only on the interstate and drops it off at a Walmart cross dock where it is pivoted and it is taken to another Walmart retail outlet on Interstate 65 near Chicago, which is a 50,000 square foot outlet. So I buy from a 500 acre farm and sell in a 50,000 square foot outlet. In India, I buy from 500 1 acre farms in and around Kolar. So the cost of aggregation, first mile aggregation, is much higher here than it is in the West. And the ability to use equipment to harvest is much more restricted. I will not say it is lower, it is much more restricted. There are different ways to use equipment than it is in the West. Similarly, in the front end, our purchase behavior is to go to a 1,000 or 2,000 square foot outlet that's in the neighborhood and buy three times a week. We do not take the car, go out to the interstate highway and buy like from a Decathlon where we buy sporting goods. That's not the behavior here. So the cost of last mile distribution is also very high. The spread that is available between farm gate and consumer is actually slightly lower compared to the West. A large part of the cost gets eaten away by both these ends. That leaves very little in between for the right method of handling, the right kind of technologies to be used, if we are replicating what's used in the West. This is the primary challenge in this category that we have encountered. A lot of our attempts have been to see how we can use a combination of physical and information technology to address some of these challenges. We've made a few beginnings. We'll share a few examples of the kind of ideas that are required in this category with a few case studies, but there's a long way to go. Now, if I step back and therefore look at the link between the producer and the consumer, there are three linkages that are therefore essential. One, physical linkage, moving the product in a manner in which it ought to be moved. We've got to remember that this is a living product. It is not an inanimate object, it's a living product which is actually losing life as it goes along. So it's almost like you're moving it in an ambulance, number one. Number two, information flow from consumer back to the producer to determine what they should produce in the first place. This is a link that not many people have focused on, including a lot of initiatives from the government sector. The consumer is unforgiving. The consumer will buy only what they want to buy. And that information, if it does not flow back, there's really little point in increasing yield. A lot of the public sector initiatives have been focused on yield improvement. If I'm improving the yield but not delivering what the consumer wants, your price is actually going to crash. And that's one of the reasons why we keep hearing about agrarian crisis, irrespective of dramatic improvements in yield. So information flow is extremely critical. And the third is the flow of money down the supply chain, which Anil has excellently covered already. Our role is to partner with Samunnati and players like them to make sure the financial supply chain is set up, but more importantly, focus on the physical and the information supply chains. And here's where some of the attempts at solving this can tend to be simplistic. For example, e-marketplaces has been something under discussion for a long time. Yes, an e-marketplace is a great idea, but how am I sure that what's shown in the photograph is what I get? Especially when I'm committing large volumes, and especially when the product is dying as it comes along. So that's the primary breakdown mode, failure mode for e-marketplaces today. So you cannot handle this only by an information linkage. There has to be a physical linkage associated with it. So our vision is to build India's largest food distribution and services company. Why large? Why scale? It is not possible to deliver impact without scale. A lot of initiatives that are in this space which are far, far better than what we are doing. We are a commercial player. I'll be very, very clear. We are a purely commercial player. we exist with, we have a social impact dashboard against which we are measured to make sure we are honest to our objective, but we remain a commercial player which wants to operate at scale. Because we believe that is the only way large scale impact can be created. More importantly, the cost structure of the industry will come down only at a certain scale, and therefore it is important to be large. Our goal is to deliver cleaner, fresher and better food products to customers. Our goal is not necessarily to give you lower and lower prices. I'd rather give my customers value for money than keep driving their prices down. I would rather transfer the prices back to my producers in the form of improved returns, while keeping a bit of myself by making the sure wastage and inefficiencies are reduced. This is really the what we've set out to build. So if you look at the supply chain, we have farmers or farmer producer organizations. We have distribution centers that we build. That is the heart of what we do as an organization. And a number of collection centers that connect to these distribution centers. Our collection centers are operated by partners. We don't operate our collection centers. And the partners are incentivized to make sure they grade the product and deliver it to me in the right form. And if the product requires processing or milling, we route it through processors or millers. And then we distribute to a range of channels, including our own retail. We have a brand called Sunny Bee, which operates a few outlets in Chennai. Retail is about 15% of our business. We go into several other categories. Now, this is where I want to illustrate a little more what Anil was describing. A farmer will produce only tomato in 1 acre. A retail customer wants 160 varieties from which she or he can choose. And that cross-linkage is what we do over here. So we buy a whole range of products from a large number of customers. We link it to a whole portfolio of customers so that the entire produce of a farmer, irrespective of grade, gets liquidated and each customer gets what they want in terms of the portfolio. This is really what we are trying to build. We also do e-commerce, but we do e-commerce in a different manner. We were just trying to work out the cost structure by which e-commerce can be made viable in this category. We just do e-commerce the way Annachi does his home delivery. You call us or you give us a WhatsApp message, we'll come and deliver to you whatever is there in the store. Our app also tells you what's there in the nearest store. We found that that's the most effective cost structure. Annachi's boy will probably come in a bicycle, my guy comes in an electric bike. That's the only difference. So in short, what we are building is direct sourcing from producers through farmer producer companies, as Anil was referring. We also operate franchise collection centers where we've converted individual farmers into entrepreneurs and made them into aggregators. And we also work with a few organized aggregators. We run short, fast supply chains with less than 2 steps. For example, if I were to give you an example of dal, if you take raw tur or raw urad or any equivalent dal, there are 11 steps between farmer and factory, farmer and mill alone. We've cut that down to 1. We actually buy from an FPU in Ponneri and deliver it directly to Virudhunagar. And post milling, we take the same product and distribute it to our clients. So we've cut it down to 1. That's the attempt that we are trying to do. And we can also add value as well. And lastly, we operate multiple channels for liquidation. We are channel agnostic. The operating mechanism remains the same irrespective of channel. We offer multiple channels for liquidation. Now, learnings that we have had in this journey so far. Farmer producer companies are a fantastic initiative by the government, but it's very hard to engage with FPCs directly. I mean, at the end of the day, these are 1,000 farmers coming together and forming a company. And the directors are also farmers, and there's a CEO who's typically appointed by them, who's a part-time. There has been, you know, large amount of distrust between farmers and, you know, players who have come into the space, which has been, you know, driven by both sides, honestly. And therefore, it's important to work with a partner everywhere if we were to make it successful. So we've done 4 things. To make sure that you know, our engagements with FPOs are sustainable. First, every single engagement we have, either an NGO or a private foundation, as an independent arbiter. So they act as our moderators, translators and judges when engaging with the farmers or the FPO on one side and with us on the other side. Otherwise, there will be opportunism on both sides. I mean, we at the senior level in the company may want to drive the company a certain way, but at the purchase manager level, given as KRAs, he might be opportunistic. On the other hand, on the FPO side, for example, if there is an agreed price and there is a sudden increase in somebody else giving a higher price, there may be a reneging of the discussion. So we need a moderator. The second is clear acceptance criteria, which are published upfront. A lot of what happens in this category are people go out to the farmers promising that they'll evacuate tons and tons of produce. And then they fail to evacuate that because it's very hard to scale. We have not done that so far. We have been consistently telling, in fact, don't give me more than 20% of what you produce. You continue to maintain your relationship with the money. You always, I'm hedging my risk, you also hedge your risk. And over time, as you build confidence in us, we'll start engaging deeper. That's the approach that we've been, by and large, taking with FPCs. And we also give the feedback to the farmers quite regularly. For example, we keep telling them, boss, just because tomato price going up, don't convert your entire 2 acres to tomato. At least split it into half. Put tomato on 1 acre and put 4 other gourds in the other acre, so you get a part of the upside and you also get hammered less if there is a downside. So that we continually give to the farmers. And we've been very, very consistent in the payment. This is almost automated now, the kind of payment process. It's cashless, electronic, automated payments. Similarly, we've learned that it is possible to convert individual farmers into entrepreneurs as well. In fact, we get 35% of our material from these farmer entrepreneurs. And the, in fact, many of these farmer entrepreneurs have now taken the first steps towards contract farming on our behalf. So they have in turn tied up contracts with individual farmers. What we have done is, in a way, we are, Anil touched upon this as well, we are sort of doing a micro samunnati over there. We provide working capital support and some capex support initially to the aggregator because they are usually not bankable. And we also create an interesting additional revenue stream for them. Onions are by and large obtained from in and around Nashik. Onions are consumed everywhere in the country. So we said, I'll get onions from the FPO in Nasik and give it to you. I'll put it in your warehouse as consignment business. You just don't buy and give to me. You also sell to the farmer back. So every farmer buys onion, the local biryani shop buys onion. So he got a revenue stream without a working capital risk because I was taking the inventory. Enabled them to actually ratchet up their revenues with a positive EBITDA very fast. And therefore they have now become bankable. So this is one example of a farmer who incorporated a company called Village Farms. He started at 3 lakhs revenue because he was only supplying to me. Around November, we switched him to this model where we said we'll give you capital and working capital support to build a small center. Not only do you buy and sell to us, you also sell the other FPO's products to the local community. He's at 32.04 lakhs. He's positive EBITDA and he's bankable. And he's got a financing for him. Now I'm asking him to pack tamarind for us. Saying form a tie up with the local SAG. And pack tamarind for us because you're bankable. Now you take a bank loan for the equipment. That's the model. So this is possible, and this is, we believe, a model that will scale for us in the future. The other thing that we've tried to do, which is yielding reasonable results, is changing the mix of cultivation in line with market demand. So these are two examples. Bharani and Ramesh are two farmers who have been working with us for years now. So many of you will actually know Bharani also. He supplies most of the organic produce in the city today. To most of the organic stores. He started off with 10 to 12 acres where he was cultivating one kind of gourd, and once that was done, he used to replace it with another kind of gourd. We worked with him to say, nah, don't do it that way. You actually cut your land up into several 1 acre plots. You plan the cropping in a way that you are delivering 10 to 12 items to me every day. Secondly, you plan it in such a way that once one field goes down, the second field starts production. And today he is able to supply to about 20 outlets in Chennai, not just to us, we are a small customer of his now. He supplies to about 20 outlets consistently 10 to 12 items every day for the throughout the year. Now the advantage for him is he doesn't need to deal, he doesn't have a problem of what do I do with the rest. Most of the farmers end up with that problem saying, okay, you guys will buy some amount, what do I do with the rest? I am dependent on the mandi, and that's where the mandi guy really introduces uncertainties to. Here, he doesn't have to do that, his entire crop gets liquidated because the consumption is in, production is in line with demand. Ramesh is also doing the same thing now, he's planting 4 goats in the same field, 2 acre field, 4 goats. And he's able to deliver 9 months. He works only with us and he gets a higher average realization of 15% when he sells to us because his overhead costs are lower, everything comes. We also are trying to do additional facilitation where, in fact, in most of our stores you will find on Sundays there will be 1 or 2 farmers. On that day, whatever they bring to the store, it is theirs. The revenue is completely theirs. The billing system is modified. They can actually take the cash from the till and go away. For us and for the farmers, this is not about doing something good to the farmer just because he's been good to us. This is about information transfer. For example, we organized a Sunday about during Pongal. We are organizing another one to commemorate the Tamil New Year. There, the farmers who came from Ottanchathiram came and said, look, I never knew that these five kinds of brinjal will sell in Chennai. They sold out in 1 hour. And price realizations are obviously very high. So now he has actually started cultivating this. This time he is going to bring several tons of brinjal over here. Now, you know, at some point in time, this information flow will cascade and they will realign themselves to this. Our objective now, and these are just experiments that we have done so far, our objective now is to see how we can build this in a sustainable manner. How I can pump consumption information back to farm clusters in a sustainable manner. We've built a standalone entity called Bharat Mandi, which is supposed to serve this function. It is an electronic data exchange where we are able to feed market information back to farmers. We're just incubating it, maybe in a year or so it will reach some maturity. The other thing is cost structures, like I was describing. In the supply chain, we cannot support Western cost structures. So we've worked with multiple farmers and government agencies to design very, very low cost collection centers. So these are about $2,000 each, about 1,20,000 each, including CCTV cameras, which we are centrally monitoring, including regular safety precautions like fire extinguishers, segregation of waste, washrooms. It's a completely hygienic center, mechanized center at $2,000. It takes exactly 8 days to set up. If a farmer wants to set up a collection center, he needs to give us one phone call. All of this fits in one Tata Ace. We can just go drop it off. It's completely modular. We had several mishaps trying to build this, but now it has reached a stage where it is becoming replicable, so now we are working with individual farmers to see what they can do. It's not just that, even the distribution center that we are building, we have tried to build it at very, very low cost using very simple mechanization. So all the conveyors in our shop, we have completely conveyorized it, because otherwise it becomes impossible to scale. You cannot, the labor required grows non-linearly compared to tonnage growth if you are doing this manually. And that's one reason why people have not been able to build scale. We operate this entirely using gravity roller conveyors. So that power is not unnecessarily consumed, product moves by itself, but there is a reasonable degree of mechanization on the shop floor. Similarly, we use a lot of simple elements that cut the costs while handling Indian situations. We have a very nice loading dock. We work out of Central Warehousing Corporation, state-of-the-art loading dock. But the trucks are not standard. Each truck has a different loading platform height. I'm kicking myself now after being in trucking for so many years. But if I were to use a dock leveler, which is a standard Western solution, that costs about 3.5 lakhs. This is our own Jugaad dock leveler. It's a simple mechanical unit which is based on an involute type of profile, which you can actually lift up and drop by using a chain. One of the boys did it during his spare time. So now this is actually adjusts itself mechanically according to different design. It costs about 3,000 rupees. It is basic physics, is what the guy has used. So everywhere we are trying to build solutions that are capable of supporting this being supported by this cost. Similarly on life extension, ideally people would say you need a complete cold chain. That is true. However, even if you break the cold chain once, the product starts deteriorating rapidly. And if I were to build a complete cold chain, then the cost structure does not support for most products. So we work, for example, with a very specific insulation. And we've actually used simple turbo ventilators, very basic solutions, and brought the shop floor temperature down by 7 degrees to 8 degrees. So today it's about 39 degrees outside, our shop floor will always be at 32 degrees. Cost us 20 rupees per square foot. Similarly, in our trucks, the normal solution is what's known as a reefer, a refrigerated truck. The challenge of the refrigerated truck is you will have a power takeoff, which sucks power out of the engine to power the air conditioning unit. Your fuel efficiency drops by 20 to 25%, and your effective cost of running your refrigerated truck is nearly 1.4 to 1.5 times, if not twice. So we worked with ICAR and we came up with a very typical Jugaad idea. First thing we said is, why don't we use the same roof insulation in the truck? So we ripped off a portion of our warehouse roof insulation, we mounted in the truck. Second, there is a reflective roof paint available from Dr. Fixit. It was more meant for housing roofing, for sheet housing. So we tried the same roof paint on top, and lastly we took a desert cooler and mounted it in there. The logic is the following. For humans, high humidity is uncomfortable. For fresh produce, high humidity is good. The reason we don't use desert coolers in a city like Chennai is our humidity is already high and we feel uncomfortable if we use it. But that's good for the product. Now the desert cooler is a simpler thing to operate. We just have an inverter connected to the electrical circuit of the vehicle, which inverts it to 240 and we just plug it in. That's all. Power consumption is negligible. We achieve 99% relative humidity inside the chamber and we have about 7 degrees reduction. This entire setup costs us 23,000 rupees. If I were to build a reefer, the refrigeration unit alone is about 95,000 to 120,000. The full truck cost me about 4 lakhs for a body. So this is something that ICAR taught us, Indian Council of Agriculture. This is the other irony over here. There's a lot of this technology lying around in ICAR, etc., which nobody has actually taken time to commercialize. So we are very thirsty for this. So we go to them and we literally take whatever technology they can offer us. So solutions like these are aplenty. They are available in different parts of the country. And if tapped in, they can help achieve the cost structures. This is another very interesting technology developed by ICAR again, Indian Institute of Horticultural Research. If we go to Western supermarkets, we typically find that for all the greens, there is a nice tube which constantly sprays water to keep it afresh. The logic is that if you take spinach, it loses 27% of its moisture in the first 8 hours when exposed. So the farmer has given you 1 kg of spinach, you are actually getting only 730 grams. That's the amount of drop that happens. And secondly, the leaves start drooping, the customers stop picking, and the cycle builds where the wastage is. ICAR has developed this technology, which is nothing but an acrylic box. All they have done is chosen the right acrylic and chosen the right dimensions. If you put the spinach in the acrylic box, it creates its own microclimate inside, where it saturates the relative humidity inside the box to 99% and then it stops transpiring. The shelf life goes up to 72 hours. We have tested this up to 72 hours without air conditioning, without power, without any water spray. It loses 3% moisture. This is available for the taking. So we've taken it now, so nobody else can take it, but we are actually spreading this technology across even our competitors. So similarly, even on the retail front, you would have observed that after Kovai Palamudhir Nilayam came into Chennai, there are a lot of Palamudhir Nilayams that have come up, which are very similar in format. But you'll also find that a lot of them are closing down, or a lot of them are actually struggling to stay afloat. Similarly, you'll find, I had shared with you earlier that modern retail is only 3% of the retail industry here in India. One is, of course, the cost of rentals, the cost of operations, and the fact that you're competing with someone who doesn't count his time as a cost. The Kirana store owner doesn't count his time as an additional cost. However, it is also to do with the capex. To set up a typical outlet like an Aditya Birla retail outlet is 2,200 rupees per square foot. This is not a sustainable cost. There are ways available. We have observed and shamelessly imitated where we found ideas on how to reduce the cost. For example, there are shelving designs in our own retail outlets where the cost structure comes down by half. Our retail outlets cost less than half of what an Aditya Birla retail outlet or a Paramudra outlet costs. We are not the best in this. There are people who are far better than us in this, and there is a lot to learn from these people to keep the capex cost down and improve the retail costs. The other area is around logistics. Here's where scale becomes critical. When you are subscale, you cannot set up an efficient supply chain to move the produce from the first mile to the last mile. As you gain in scale, you are able to slowly bring the cost down. And the problem is many people give up at a certain scale saying, look, this is not looking viable and I'm not ready to spend any more time on it. Our own experience has been that way. For example, in September, our movement from Hosur to Chennai used to cost about 6.70 rupees a kg. Most of the people are advising us to give up on this, saying, look, don't do this farm business, just pick it up from the market. But we persisted on it, and of course, we did some optimization, but it is primarily driven by scale. It has come down to 3.2 rupees. So this is again to emphasize the need for patience and scale building in this category. Until then, you've got to incur some initial losses and stick to it. There are ways in which you can mitigate these losses. For example, we picked up clientele in and around Hosur, where we used to do reverse logistics of products from Chennai, imported fruits or onions and garlic, etc., which came from the north. We used to do reverse logistics. That brought down our cost by about 15% or so. So the supply chains, we believe, need to be designed in entirety, and there needs to be some patience behind you to make it to scale. And this is one area where, by the way, if a lot of people contemplating to get into space will face a challenge when it comes to investors. Many of them don't have the patience to let you scale till that point, and you need the right kind of investors to back you to Not just that, there are some products that will require cold chain, but there are technologies available which actually help you use the cold chains in a very different way compared to the West. For example, there is a company called Uflex that does modified atmosphere packs. The plastic packs that you see there are not just plain plastic, they are perforated with micro perforations using a laser. That helps the product breathe at a very slow rate. It's almost as if the product is in artificial coma. That extends the shelf life of the product to about 7 days. Now, what is the advantage of this? In our case, we use this very differently. A lot of our customers are now wanting exotic items from OT, like lettuces and so on. But our consumption was only 150 kgs a day. I can't run a refrigerated truck for 150 kgs a day. This packaging gave us 7 days shelf life. And therefore, we were able to fill the truck. So it is thinking like this that requires to be done in order to make the cold chain effective. Today, a lot of the cold chains are ineffective because they are subscale. And if you are able to scale the cold chain, then the effectiveness of the cold chain improves. And that shift in thinking is necessary. The same solution gave us 50% lower dump for strawberries. This is a very interesting observation we had. When we were able to maintain a supply chain at 16 degrees Celsius from source to end, the dump dropped by 50% because one, the product didn't rot, secondly, it was a faster supply chain. The consumption of strawberry in Chennai went up 3 times. So there was a pent-up demand. What was happening was the retailers were not putting the strawberry because there was so much wastage on the shelf. Once this technology came in and wastage started getting reduced, the volume went up 3 times. And imagine what that does to the farmer. Strawberry is a premium product. They get a much higher rupee per kg on that. So combination of these technologies is critical. Lastly, like I had said earlier, the customer is unforgiving. The purchase manager or the chef of a restaurant doesn't care whether you're getting it from the farmer or anybody else. They need their fill rates. At 11 o'clock, everything needs to be delivered to them, otherwise everybody will throw a fit. Our own processes, which are actually still at a low level of maturity, are so complex today to make sure those fill rates are met. We have a first fill that happens. One classic problem that we face is my customer will place an order on me at 11 o'clock today in the night for tomorrow morning 11 o'clock delivery. I have to place an order into the farmer 24 hours before because I have to bring it from 400 kilometers away. Predictive modeling becomes very, very critical here. And in predictive modeling, there are complications again. If I take the entire retail vertical of ours, the retail vertical runs by the Indian calendar. It does not run by the English calendar. On Amavasya, one day before Amavasya, in my Nanganallu store, I'd better have ash gourd and raw banana, otherwise my store will be shut down. Just before Ramzan, I'd better have papaya for that full month in Palavakam store, otherwise I'll be in trouble. So, we actually had to learn this and start building some tools that work as per the effectively by the Indian calendar and can be tuned to each local locality's requirement in order to be able to improve the prediction rates. It's starting to work now, but there is a long way to go. Here is where any work on AI will be very useful. AI or machine learning will be very useful in drawing patterns from all cash tills and actually reflecting it back in the form of forecasts. Not just that, we have advanced shipping notes, we send a shortfall purchase order in case one farmer declines. I mean, the farmer will give what they give. We cannot hold the farmer to give 95% fill rates. We will have to make up for the shortfall through another cluster, if not from the market, if not from our own retail outlet, and if not from a third party retail outlet. And all of this has to be looked back. We've reached a certain level on this in fill rates. We have been able to achieve consistent 100% fill rates. We are not able to do it on time yet. Our timeliness is still only 80%. We still have to improve. So, these are some of the challenges that we face. And of course, there are difficulties. I mean, these are typically the terrain which we need to operate in to pick up material. Often it will be underwater. Some of our trucks have snorkels because it has to float 2 feet of water during monsoon in Hosur district. So, a lot of these challenges are quite common. And of course, the primary goal is we do a lot of this in the back end, but if the buying experience is this, it is not really rewarding. And this was really the challenge we faced when we got in. Nobody wanted to buy from us, that's a separate factor, but even those who wanted to buy from us were selling their product like this, which wasn't really a very good way to do it. Which is honestly why we got into retail. Our intention was never to get into retail, we are primarily a supply chain player. This is what we built, this store. And this is a very low capex store, everything is recycled, shipping pallets and things like that, just some basic disinfecting and painting has been done. But it's a reasonably presentable atmosphere for people to go in and buy their products. course, we are also building an omni-channel experience, but like I said, the challenge with e-commerce here is that, you know, the cost structure again does not work if you do traditional e-commerce. In our case, the, what we are doing is, like I said, it's the Anachi model. You call our store or you send a WhatsApp message, the boys will come on an electric bike and deliver it to you. It's as simple as that. The reasonably low cost. Again, there is very limited talent available in this industry. It's extremely critical to build organizational depth organically in order to achieve scale in this. Secondly, you have to build continually maturing systems, processes and controls. If we scale too much, we lose control in the form of leakages across the supply chain. And lastly, we need a seamless IT platform across the value chain. We've made attempts at it. These are very early days. I will not claim any success in this. In our case, we actually have designed a fairly depth, we've very safely replicated our learnings from the automotive industry here. We have multi-layers. We have fairly detailed training programs across multiple levels. But still, we've had to do something out of the box in order to get the talent into this category in the first place. This is not a glamorous segment. So we, for example, have become a certified training institute by the Apprenticeship Board of Government of India. We take people who are 10th pass but could not continue education. We have offer them an earned while you learn program and a stipend while they are at it, and that's how really they enter our system. We also partner with NGOs who have specially abled people who come onto our platform. We try to map skills. For example, people who are on the autism spectrum, they are more likely to do stuff like merchandising and arranging products. People who have physical disabilities are more likely to work on the till. So we do that mapping, but other than that, they are treated like regular employees. The objective is to really grow this talent. In middle management also, we have taken people from a number of colleges, typically in the rural areas. The top management, we have actually, because none of us are from the industry, we have actually recruited a lot of people from the industry to serve as mentors for this talent over time. That's the method that we've been following. Again, we have a lot of folks who have retired and joined us. They're still energetic, they want to contribute, they see impact over here, they've joined us, and they act as mentors in this category. Again, like I talked about fire controls, I will not go into the details of this. And lastly, there are so many platforms at work in our facility already. We are still figuring out how to integrate all of this. We're doing a reasonable job of it right now. But there is a substantial amount of IT backbone required to drive scalability, otherwise you lose control. One thing we have done is we work with GoFrugal Technologies to build a single version of truth across the organization. GoFrugal has built a custom ERP for us that ties all the way into their POS, which we use. So we get all transactions now are on one platform. And all the other pieces of technology like our GPS system, our delivery executive tracking system, all of that tie into this ERP platform. But to create visibility, there is substantial infusion of technology that's required, which in turn is throwing up a large amount of data which powers our analytics. That's really the cycle that we are kicking off. I'll summarize. So fresh produce supply chain in India requires a unique set of solutions that work for Indian operating conditions. This is necessary. Every element of the value chain needs to be solved for and not just one portion. We will not solve this problem by focusing on yield alone. We will not solve this problem by having a pretty store alone. Every element needs to be solved afresh. The focus should be on frugal engineering across the supply chain, seamless integration of physical and information technology, and continual strengthening of control and scalability elements, and constant reduction of risk. The entire inefficiency and cost in this industry is because of risk. The more we work to reduce the risk to each stakeholder over here, the better off we are at it. Physical technology helps in doing that, information technology helps in doing that. Availability of finance at lower and lower rates starts reducing the risk exposure. That's really what we are out to. Like I said, we moved from nascency to infancy, ably handheld by folks like Samunathi. Hopefully we'll continue to do that and grow into a certain level. Please take this as the observations of an interested outsider coming into this category for the first time. I'll put a large disclaimer at the end once again. Thank you.